Good morning and welcome on this Sunday service. Just to confuse all of you, obviously this is Alison's kitchen and Alison's table, but I'm with you this morning. So we have our call to worship. And of course you'll see all the words to join in up on the to the side of me. The call to worship is from Psalm 105, which is actually our psalm for today. Give thanks to the Lord, call on his name, make known among the nations what he has done. Sing to him, sing praise to him, tell of all his wonderful acts. Glory in his holy name. Let the hearts of those who seek the Lord rejoice. Look to the Lord and his strength. Seek his face always. And we have a time of prayer. Loving God, who holds out the hand of friendship, the hand of love, the hand of strength and of salvation, as we travel through this life with its storms and with its calm and quiet times, hold us tight in your love, in your grace and in your mercy. Help us, Lord, not to fear, but to reach back to you in all that you are and the promise that we have in your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. And we're going to sing our first song now, A Child of God. And I invite you just to sing loud and sing praise to God and declare who you are in him.
You unravel me with a melody. You surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemies, till all my fears have come. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child. Child of God.
I hope you enjoyed that song. It really is one of my favourites and I love singing it really, really loud. We're going to come to our time of confession now. And I invite you all to just take a few seconds and do your business with God before we join together. Loving God, we come before you now in all that we are. You see our brokenness, yet you love us beyond compare. Lord, have mercy. So often we fall short, but your hand still reaches for us. Lord, have mercy. We fail to love you as we should, yet you are patient. Lord, have mercy. We get caught up in the busyness of life and neglect you, but you are constant. Lord, have mercy. We fail to love and forgive others as you have forgiven us. Lord, have mercy. In many ways we fail you, God. From the depths of our hearts, we are sorry. Now, obviously, as a mere ordinand, I cannot give you absolution. But as a Christian, I can say to you that God does forgive our sins when we come to him and confess. But I would like to read these reassuring words from Psalm 103. The Lord is compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in love. He will not always accuse, nor will he harbour his anger forever. He does not treat us as our sins deserve, or repay us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his love for those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us. Amen. So we're going to say the Gloria together now. We're going to glorify God, and the words will be up on the screen for you.
Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen.
We come to the time for our first reading. Deborah is going to give us the reading from Genesis 37 today.
Genesis chapter 37, Joseph's dreams. Jacob lived in the land where his father had stayed, the land of Canaan. This is the account of Jacob. Joseph, a young man of 17, was tending the flocks with his brothers, the sons of Bilhah and the sons of Zilpah, his father's wives, and he brought their father a bad report about them. Now Israel loved Joseph more than any other of his sons, because he had been born to him in his old age, and he made a richly ornamented robe for him. When his brothers saw that their father loved him more than any of them, they hated him and could not speak a kind word to him. Now his brothers had gone to graze their father's flocks near Shechem, and Israel said to Joseph, "As you know, your brothers are grazing the flocks near Shechem. Come, I am going to send you to them." "Very well," he replied. So he said to him, "Go and see if all is well with your brothers and with the flocks, and bring word back to me." Then he set off from the valley of Hebron. When Joseph arrived in Shechem, a man found him wandering in the fields and asked him, "What are you looking for?" He replied, "I'm looking for my brothers. Can you tell me where they're grazing their flocks?" "They have moved on from here," the man answered. "I heard them say, 'Let's go to Dothan.'" So Joseph went after his brothers and found them near Dothan, but they saw him in the distance, and before he reached them, they plotted to kill him. "Here comes that dreamer," they said to each other. "Come now, let's kill him and throw him into one of these cisterns and say that a ferocious animal devoured him. Then we'll see what comes of his dreams." When Reuben heard this, he tried to rescue him from their hands. "Let's not take his life," he said. "Don't shed any blood. Throw him into this cistern here in the desert, but don't lay a hand on him." Reuben said this to rescue him from them and take him back to his father. So when Joseph came to his brothers, they stripped him of his robe, the richly ornamented robe he was wearing, and they took him and threw him into the cistern. Now the cistern was empty. There was no water in it. As they sat down to eat their meal, they looked up and saw a caravan of Ishmaelites coming from Gilead. Their camels were loaded with spices, balm and myrrh, and they were on their way to take them to Egypt. Judah said to his brothers, "What will we gain if we kill our brother and cover up his blood? Come, let's sell him to the Ishmaelites and not lay our hands on him. After all, he is our brother, our own flesh and blood." His brothers agreed. So when the Midianite merchants came by, his brothers pulled Joseph up out of the cistern and sold him for 20 shekels of silver to the Ishmaelites, who took him to Egypt.
Thank you, Deborah, for that. Our gospel reading today is from the book of Matthew, chapter 14, verses 22 to 33. Immediately, Jesus made his disciples get into the boat and go on ahead of him to the other side, while he dismissed the crowd. After he had dismissed them, he went up on a mountainside by himself to pray. When evening came, he was there alone, but the boat was already a considerable distance from the land, buffeted by the waves because the wind was against it. During the fourth watch of the night, Jesus went out to them, walking on the lake. When the disciples saw him walking on the lake, they were terrified. "It's a ghost," they said, and cried out in fear. But Jesus immediately said to them, "Take courage. It is I. Don't be afraid." "Lord, if it is you," said Peter, "tell me to come to you on the water." "Come," he said. Then Peter got down out of the boat, walked on the water, and came towards Jesus. But when he saw the wind, he was afraid, and beginning to sink, he cried out, "Lord, save me." Immediately Jesus reached out his hand and caught him. "You of little faith," he said, "why did you doubt?" And when they climbed down into the boat, the wind died down. Then those who were in the boat worshipped him, saying, "Truly, you are the Son of God." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Loving God, I pray now that these words I speak are the words that you want us to hear. Speak into our hearts, Lord, as we listen. Amen. Wow, so this passage is such an exciting passage, isn't it? The disciples are in a boat and there's a storm, there's a ghostly apparition, there's a miracle, then there's another miracle, and of course there's the rescue. I think this passage has two strands to it. One that challenges us and teaches us, and one that reassures us and shows us the awesomeness of God. We have the example of faith, which is in Peter, and then we have the nature of God shown to us by Jesus. This is a story of faith and grace, a story of trust and of belief, of focus, and the reality of God's love for each of us. Faith, I think, is both a beautiful thing and a challenging thing. It's the thing that enables us to be bold and brave. It's that thing that enables us to, not literally, but enables us to step out of the boat, to take a leap, and knowing that in our own strength and left to our own devices, we might not succeed, but our faith enables us and encourages us to keep looking to God. And trusting in Him and looking to Him, we discover that anything is possible. It gives us hope and it changes the way that we see the world around us. And also it does challenge us. It challenges the very people that we are, the lives that we lead, what we do. Every single aspect of our lives is challenged by our faith. Everything, what we watch on TV, what we spend our money on, how we bring up our children, how we are with other people, and also how we feel about ourselves. Our faith reaches into the very core of our being. It makes us step out of our comfort zones. It forces us out of those nice places that we like to be, where we can be at ease and be cozy. I wonder how your faith shapes and continues to shape your life. Where have you seen God strengthening you? Where have you been able to do something that you wouldn't have thought possible? How does your hope in Jesus help you live? How have you been challenged? That's always an interesting one. And how did you respond to that challenge? Peter gives us an example of what faith can look like. And just like ours, it's not perfect. I think how reassuring is that for us? Peter, the kind of head disciple, one of the closest people to Jesus, the rock on whom the church was built, just like us, he got it wrong sometimes. He lost focus just for a second, but he did lose focus. And I think it probably happens to us all at some point in our lives. But we can still draw out a picture of faith from his example. He hears his Lord's voice, that ghostly apparition that frightened them all to death. Even before they can see him properly, they hear him speaking, and he is speaking directly into their situation. He knows how they're feeling. He knows what they're facing. He knows them all intimately, and he can speak right into the very heart of the issue. Don't be afraid. And Jesus speaks into all our lives, calling us, telling us not to be afraid sometimes, and reassuring us, guiding us. And there is so much power in that spoken word. It is how the whole universe was brought into being in the first place. So when Jesus speaks to us, it is with that same power, that power that creates and forms, the same power that performs miracles, the same power that defeated death for us all. The words of Jesus form and transform lives, all our lives. But do we hear him? I hope so. How do we respond to him? Well, Peter, for all the fluff-ups that he made, wanted to be as close to Jesus as he could possibly be. He wanted to know and wanted to do all the stuff that Jesus knew and did. Even walk on water in the middle of a storm. Now, I'm not saying that we should ever try that, but I wonder how close we are to Jesus and the way he lived his life. Do we truly follow his example in our daily lives? Do we love the unlovable? Do we speak up and act in the face of injustice? Do we walk in peace, but with a strength and wisdom that only God can give us? Do we truly look to God and rely on him for all things? I think that if I was in a boat in the middle of a storm, the first thing that I would ask God for would be to stop the storm and get us to safety. What Peter asks for, though, is totally fascinating. He doesn't ask for those things. He asks Jesus to give him a command. He asks Jesus to tell him what to do. So often, we can expect God to sort out life's problems for us. When we pray, we can give him a shopping list of what we want in order to make life good or better for us. But what should we be doing? What does God want us to do? We are the body of Christ. We are not passive beings. We can do, say, and act. But we need to know God's will. God, what do you want us to do? What do you want me to do? When we know and do his will, anything is possible. Look at Peter. We are active participants in life with God, partners with the creator of the world. He will enable us on our journey with him, equip and strengthen us for our role in his kingdom. But we need to take the initiative. We need to seek God. He does not force himself upon us. We must go to him in all areas of life, in the storms of life, the uncertain times, the joyful times. He is there waiting for us. And this is the most beautiful thing of our faith. He is waiting for us. He is there with his hand, ready to take ours whenever we need him to. The hand of friendship, safety, the hand of love. And this is grace, that no matter how we might mess up, no matter if we might take our eyes off him and lose our focus for only a second, if we rely on ourselves and not on him, when we're scared or overwhelmed. His love is so big and so forgiving that when we shout for help, he is there for us. He's there to help us to succeed, to make us whole in our lives, and to rescue us. Now, it doesn't happen very much now, certainly not with my two biggest boys, but sometimes with Beau. I love it when we're out and he kind of forgets himself as he's grown up almost, and he takes my hand. And I know that for him, it makes him feel safe, there's reassurance, there's also a sense of my mum, and I love thinking this is my boy. It's a sign of intimate relationship to hold someone's hand. So I hope and pray that we can all reach out and take hold of God's hand. He is our God and we are his children. And I praise him for always being there, for reaching out to us, and not just when we need rescuing, but all the time. Amen. And we come now to the Creed. I invite you all to profess your faith in God. So let us profess our faith together.
Do you believe and trust in God the Father, source of all being and life, the one for whom we exist? We believe and trust in him. Do you believe and trust in God the Son, who took our human nature, died for us and rose again? We believe and trust in him. Do you believe and trust in God the Holy Spirit, who gives life to the people of God and makes Christ known in the world? We believe and trust in him. This is the faith of the Church. This is our faith. We believe and trust in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
And Chris will now lead us in our prayers of intercession.
We pray for the Church and for the world, and we thank God for his goodness. We thank you, Lord, for the nice weather, for the fact that we've been able to get out and meet friends outside in our gardens. And we pray for those who haven't got gardens, who struggle to meet friends outside. We pray for those in parts of the world where they haven't got nice weather, where their weather is flooding or drought. We pray for those parts of East Africa where they're plagued by locusts, adding to the problems of COVID and already drought. Lord, we pray for our neighbours, for those that we know and those that we don't know, for those that we nod and say hello to, for those that we're friendly with, and for those that ignore us and that we ignore. Please help us not to ignore them. Lord, at this time, we pray for those involved in medicine, those involved in our hospitals, doctors, whatever job they do. They must be exhausted. Lord, help them. Give them rest. Help them cope with the trauma. We pray for those who are ill and for those who are frightened of becoming ill. Lord, help us have faith in you. There are times when we feel we could walk on water with you, but there are times, many more times, when we doubt. Lord, help us to see that it's your grace that saves us,
nor anything we can do. That doesn't mean we don't have to do stuff. Lord, help us to help others. Help us to be your hands and feet. Help us to be what you want us to be, the best people we can be. Lord, we ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, Chris. Let us say the Lord's Prayer together.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
So we come to the time in the service where we usually share the peace together, and I know it's really difficult because we obviously can't do that in a physical way, but we could still share the peace of God together. So I invite you to hold out your hands as a sign of giving and of receiving God's peace. As I say, the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you, and also with you. We're going to sing our next song now, Faithful One, so I hope you enjoy it.
Faithful One, so
Faithful One, so unchanging.
With my cup of tea, but whatever you have, obviously. God invites us to his table, each and every one of us. So with your cup of tea and your biscuits, or whatever you have, join in with this meal of remembrance, gifted to us by Jesus, as we remember the sacrifice that he made on our behalf. Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Glory be to you, Lord Most High. Heavenly Father, accept our praises through your Son, our Saviour Jesus Christ, as we follow his example and obey his command. By the power of your Holy Spirit, grant that the gifts that we bring into your presence may be like his body and blood. Father, on the night your Son was betrayed, he shared a meal with his disciples. He took the bread and he gave you thanks. He broke it and, giving it to his disciples, said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup, and again he gave you thanks. He gave it to the disciples, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this often in remembrance of me." Heavenly Father, we remember this willing sacrifice made by Jesus on the cross and proclaim his glorious and mighty resurrection as we look for his coming kingdom. Great is the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Father, we pray that through your Son, you accept our sacrifice of thanks and praise as we share in this meal in your divine presence. Renew us, inspire us, and unite us with your Son by the power of your Holy Spirit. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. Amen. So let us now share our meal and take just a few seconds now to open up our hearts to Jesus in thanks and praise. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Let us now pray together. Lord God, the source of truth and love, keep us faithful to the apostles' teaching and fellowship. United in prayer and the breaking of bread, and one in joy and simplicity of heart, in Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. So, we're nearly at the end of our service now, but no church service is complete without the notices. And I haven't been given really any to say, apart from that, just to remind you that there's no services next week, as Alison is on holiday. But you are encouraged to look at other local churches around us, and also to have a look at the readings and just sit quietly with those readings that we would normally have in a service and let them speak to you. This is an opportunity not to have a sermon but to hear from the boss directly. So we're going to have our last song, which is also our blessing. And I do encourage you to sing it, to join in and sing with it, because I think it's a blessing that we can give each other in this way. So I hope you enjoy it.
Bless us and keep us. smile on us, shine His light upon us. May the Lord lift up, turn His face towards us, give us His peace, give us His peace. Blessed we came to this place today, and blessed now we will go. In the name of the Father, the Spirit and the Son.
It's been a real joy to be here with you today and take this service, and I do pray that God does make His face shine on each of you, and that you will receive His blessing. I pray that you will all know peace and fulfillment in your lives through Jesus, our Saviour. Amen.